And they're symbolic. In that day, the seven strongest churches were these that were mentioned in Revelation. They were symbolic of the church that one day would be worldwide. In those days, they didn't even know all of the world. They didn't even know there was an America and a South America and a Northern America and Canada and all. They didn't even know all of that existed. They only knew their world that they were familiar with. But one, the day would come when all the world would know about Jesus. And there would be churches in every country, in every place. I've been to Africa many times as a missionary. And I've been to Cambodia and the Philippines and to Peru. And I can't even remember all the places. And everywhere I went, nearby somewhere, was a church. And I'll tell you, the church that I found the most was Calvary Chapel. Everywhere I went, there was a Calvary Chapel. There was also a Baptist church. But there were more Calvary Chapels than there were Baptist churches where I went. But that doesn't matter. The point is that they are evangelical churches that are preaching the truth and preaching the gospel. And that's what he means when he says worldwide. It's believers everywhere. Now, it says here specifically that the seven lampstands are the seven churches. So the lampstands that Jesus stands on represents churches everywhere. But look what it says about the seven stars. The seven stars are the angels of the seven churches. Now, does that mean that every church has its own private angel?
No.
I don't think so. I don't think that's what it's saying. What is the basic word mean that we translate as angel? It's messenger. Now, it can mean many things. It can mean a prophetic messenger. It can mean a messenger of mercy. It can mean a messenger with an important message to give, a specific thing. But angel literally means message. Now, we've always recognized that, of course, the angels are God's messengers. But pastors of churches are referred to as angels too. Not because we're so good, but because we are God's messenger to this lampstand, to this assembly of believers. And so what he's saying literally here, he's sending this message as for the mystery. I am sending this to the church and its messenger so that everyone will hear the truth of what is to eventually happen, what is coming about, what is going to be brought. Now, there's a couple of other things that I think are important. It refers to spirits. And I want you to turn to Isaiah chapter 11. And I hope I marked it. I think I did. Because this is interesting. Referring to spirits. Now, usually we think in terms of the Spirit of God, right? And it talks about the seven spirits. Does that mean there are seven spirits moving around? Look at this. And it's found in Isaiah chapter 11. It says, "Then a shoot will spring forth from the stem of Jesse, and a branch from his roots will bear fruit." Now, think about this for a minute. Who was from the stem of Jesse?
David.
King David. King David's father's name was Jesse. And so the reference that Isaiah is making here is the one that came forth from Jesse, who became the leader of Israel, the king of Israel. But even more than that, who came from the lineage of David?
Jesus.
Jesus did. And so when Isaiah is talking about a shoot will spring forth from the stem of Jesse and a branch from his roots will bear fruit, they're talking about Jesus and his spirit and the spirit of the, now listen to this, follow along, and the spirit of the Lord will rest upon him. That's one. And the spirit of wisdom is two. The spirit of understanding is three. The spirit of counsel is four. The spirit of strength is five. The is 6, and the fear of the Lord is 7. Those are the 7 spirits of God. Because when Jesus represents himself and reveals himself to us, all of these things are present, and they are symbolized by the 7 lampstands, the 7 spiritual lampstands representing these things of God. So, when Jesus refers to these things, it's important that we know exactly what he's talking about. Now, one final thing. I want you to turn to Zechariah. Remember Zechariah? We don't have too many messages out of the book of Zechariah. But it's full of good stuff. In chapter 4 of Zechariah, verses 1 and 2, Zechariah was having an experience with God and an angel was speaking to him. Now, I'm not going to go into why and all that, but it says in verse 1, "Then the angel who was speaking with me returned and roused me as a man who is awakening from his sleep. And he said to me, 'What do you see?' And I said, 'I see and behold, a lampstand, all of gold, with its bowl on the top, and its 7 lamps on it, with 7 sprouts belonging to each of the lamps which are on the top of it. Also 2 olive trees by it, one on the right side of the bowl, and the other is on its left.'" In other words, this is not new stuff to John. Zechariah was seeing this stuff too. Now he's a little more in detail about the lampstands. And he's a little more in detail. Isaiah's a little more in detail about the spirits. But you see, what's happening with John, all of these things that's been throughout the Bible are being brought together in this vision that Jesus is giving you. And after this introduction with Revelation that we've had today, we are going to pick up from here, and we are going to look at the message specifically to each of the 7 churches. Now, that's going to begin in the next session with Revelation, but I want you to know what's coming. The churches are symbolic to us as well. So the message to the churches is also a message to us as a church, but also to us as an individual. And Jesus becomes specific when he talks about, "I like this that I see in you, but I don't like this that I see in you."
Amen.
"And I rebuke this that I see in you, and I praise you for this that I see in you." He gets right down to the nitty-gritty. So every church that we'll be talking about will also identify some things that we need to look for in ourselves to please God, and that we need to perhaps deal with that are not pleasing God. Now, I'm going to stop there today. We'll pick up next time in chapter 2, starting with verse 1. I'd like you to stand, please. And Dan, we're going to just go right on to he's the savior of the soul. And Daniel's going to play that for a moment, and I just want you to know your hands. Let's take a moment to think about what we've heard, where we are with the Lord today. With every head bowed and every eye closed, think about where you are with God. Think about the things that you are troubled about. Think about the things that aren't working maybe in your life. Certainly, that you would look down upon us and that you would quicken our hearts to obey you, to obey the word, and to seek to be the person you called us to be. I know it's easy, Lord. We all fall into temptation. We all trip over the words of Satan. We fall into flesh and the world, but God, today, this moment, this time here, give us strength and power in the Holy Spirit to overcome the things of Satan, the things of the world, the things of the flesh, to overcome and to resist. Help us to be all that you've called us to be. Father, we love you and praise you so much. And I pray your blessings upon this people this morning. Let's sing together this song. He's the Savior of us. He's the Savior of my soul, my Jesus, my Jesus. He's the Savior of my soul. He's the Savior.
Everybody said,
amen.